What you got there?
I got the old mesquite. The Song Dance Flame. How's that smell? Good stuff, huh? Mm-hmm.
I knew very little about his country. When I mentioned to my parents where he was from, they had absolutely no idea, clueless. He had been, we were in gym class at the same time, and his concrete wall separated the boys from the girls. And apparently there was a little hole in the wall that the girls were unaware of. And so he called for me. We, you know, didn't know from Adam who we were, but he called for Betty. Betty Miller was my maiden name. And so I came over, and he's making a date through the wall in front of all of these women, dressed in underwear, you name it. That's how we actually met. And then we went on our first date.
Do we have any matches?
Yeah, we have.
I couldn't find the matches upstairs either.
They're up on the stove.
They are?
Oh, I looked in the wrong place. What do I know? I just work here.
Well, we got a pyramid here.
Now all we need is a match. Remember, two of them. That's why I said, boy, something wrong with it. I can't see it. The Song Festival flame has that just been lit.
Yeah, I was totally uninterested in them. I wasn't dating at the time anyway, but I was in the color guard. And so we went to all the football games, parades, etc. And we had a nighttime parade before a football game. And I guess he had seen me and pulled me or helped me over the storm fence on the field. And I guess that's where we actually got a little to know each other.
Okay. Kusa kuset kuivat heinat.
What?
Said, where are you peeing? That's dry hay.
I'll have to learn that one before I go.
I guess I can brush.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Everything is done over there except for the cat food.
It's nice and early, huh?
Yeah.
Are you already at it, huh? The day of the big trip.
Inimesed kolisid sinna uute maja, mitte juus, vaid nad müüsid maja ääri, siis teised omanikud kolisid sisse ja siis tegid Mississippi korrat maja ette. Aga ma peaaegu kukkusin nina peale ja ma ütlesin, Mississippi ja vesi jooksis ka seal siia.
Kuulge lakmed, kantsu peale, võtkem sõbraga ja tuju läheveaks. Tegelikult see meil huvitab ja kaera ja on olnud edes. Ole tarvitusi, et rütmi
with this Cojera.
Hey,
fica ahí, hola. Hey, Felix. Till I see you, man. Huh? Yeah. Hey, that witch. Not the guy. Fica, no. The provis, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, just must have been there. I'm tunned. Me, they all me. Neli aastat näinud, jah.
Hais on
tunned. Hais on. Tunned või? She said, your smell is still the same, even though you haven't been there for 4 years. He ought to, you know, recognize. Nüüd hakkab mängima. This was built in 1939 as a summer home. I mean, this was, you know, essentially, you know, out country-wise here, and, yeah. Yeah, before the,
so. All this area was fields.
Yeah. Yeah. And swamps. Fields and swamps, yeah. 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 Mm-hmm. Yeah, she asked me if mine was the flowery carry-on. I said, well, yeah, it's my nature. You know. I always can see you.
It's a nice bag you got there.
Thank you. It's the new fashion. It says, ciao. This is usually how it would sit around a table and solve all the world's problems.
Yeah. Sometimes over 10 people there.
And this is, you know, in case you want to. It's the WC.
Only babies pee in their pants. That's on a record. Yeah, it's one chapter. It's Laura pees in her pants.
Bad Laura.
Bad Laura, yes.
They go back, if I remember, about 3500 BC, so they're about 5,500 years old.
They're boat-shaped, and apparently, again, you know, the larger ones were more distinguished people and so on.
They had elders. It was pretty democratic. Yeah, you had to earn your way instead of, you know, passing it on to your son and all your family. But this is the biggest one right here. Estonians had one of the main fortifications was here, and again it was never overrun. It was, I mean, they essentially had a siege and, you know, essentially waited them out after a while, but it was never overrun.
Estonian fortifications go back to about, they started to pop up
around 1000 BC. Now, Estonian history, it's, you know, from archaeological findings and everything else, goes back to roughly 10,000 years. So it's a very ancient culture, language, etc.
I mean, it's really important in the history of Estonia, and actually there's a ancient love song about rowing your sweetheart across Viljandi, Lake Viljandi. You can just imagine how much work went in just to dig something like this out without bulldozers. We were, when we first got here, and my sister and I, and I don't know who else with us, we were going, starting to go by the old ammunition storage area, and there was an elderly gentleman sitting there, my sister asked him, you know, which way is the best to go into the fortification. He said, but you know, in introducing the story, he said, well, the old conquerors lived over here. This not now. This was during Soviet times. The new ones are right in there, which was the former communist headquarters. It was so fun. I mean, I just almost just, you know, I couldn't help but break up. I mean, and he said it with a, you know, like he was lecturing, you know, very seriously. The old masters were over there, and the new ones are right over there. Now, this is the way you get into the castle. So you get on both sides, and you start going back and forth.
You're like 40 people.
Yeah.
Depends on the side of it.
No, laminates.
So what is this called?
Kiik.
Swing.
Yeah. Swing is kiik in Estonian.
But you're saying it's a traditional.
Yeah.
Oh, this is very traditional Estonian. The style or architecture of it, you know. So you get on, you get both sides going, and you just...
You get it like 90 degrees up.
Yeah. And actually, like I said, the good ones will swing around. This is a klutzer. And you know, most places where they have the Yanni Bag, the midsummer event with the large bonfires and everything, they always have a swing or two around. Mm-hmm. It's almost like a contest, you know, who can get it higher.
I have had some good parties in that where my mother lives, the midsummer party, you know, everything's drunk and somebody falls out and it like lands there.
Oh, where am I?
Nothing yet. I'm okay.
It's one of the largest fortifications in Estonia. Siege tower over here was put here about, I don't know, about 10 years ago, just to show some of the warfare tactics, you know, back then. What we see here today are the earthen foundations of the wall. It was like this, and then they built wooden fortifications on top of that, and towers and so forth. got to get altitude sickness now. Don't forget, it goes all the way up to 1,000 feet.
We have to stay here for a couple of days.
Yeah, right. We have to rest as you go up. For. Here we are at altitude 380 meters, 18 excuse me, 1,000 feet, and our grandson is right on top there. That's a couple more feet. Reservoir was not there. So as I mentioned, there was a meadow there that we had a bunch of kids here that we always played soccer there. They couldn't walk. Or during the summer, we'd go swimming in the river. And over here, if you look down a river, it's roughly around a bend here where a couple of Stone Age soldiers came by. One was a relative. I don't remember who he was, but anyway, they wanted to get some quick stuff for dinner, and of course we were going to fry them up, so went around a bend and they threw a couple of hand grenades into the water, and it would just pick the fish off from the concussion and took them home and fried them. That's the first time I saw how to fish with hand grenades, or how to fish real fast without any effort. But again, it was really interesting to a 9-year-old. When you get a couple of hands, they didn't throw them in all at one time. You throw one in and you get this explodes underwater, and just great mass of water just pops up. And you throw another one and it pops up, and all of a sudden you got these fish floating on top. This is where I got started with education. How's that? Okay, so it's a beauty salon and a hardware store now. This was my first grade, and I think I came close to finishing because I was here at least a year, and then they turned it into a military hospital, and that was the end. Of course, we could play more soccer and have fun. And that's why I'm kind of always a couple of years behind my compatriots, age-wise. It's funny how I don't remember a teacher from here, but I remember recess and back of the house. That's the most important part. The ladies, did you notice them looking out the window in the beauty parlor?
No.
Very interested in what you're doing.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah. Hey, I should have brought my pink bag. I fitted right in. I just talked to that. I mean, just said this was my first schoolhouse through the window. Want to just stick your head in and take a shot at the girls? Kas me võime teist natuke filmi võtta? Tule siis. See on mu tütrepoeg. Ta räägib inglise keelt muidugi. Ta õiget keelt ei üldse ei tunne. Yeah, this is the church where I attended several funerals, and I don't know if I attended any weddings, but in the old times, I don't know about right now, but you really can't tell the difference between a wedding and a funeral. It's celebrated for 3 days anyway, so. But let's take a walk up to the door. Last time I was here, couldn't get in. It was locked. They may be still locked up because they don't want any vandalism. But again, like all the other churches, and it's a Lutheran church. It was essentially shut down. There were no services during Soviet times. or maybe there were, but you know, nothing to write home about. Oh, great! It's open. It'll be the first time I get to go in there. He's good.
Hello.
Hello. Good.
He's the new preacher.
Oh, yeah. Great.
Right. Yeah. So you can come in if you like.
Thank you. Dore, dore, dore. Yeah, this is where I attended a lot of weddings and funerals.
Right.
I don't know if I was Christian here or not. I probably was, but... Now, these are still the old benches, except they've been painted. Because I didn't remember a white paint. This is the place where we came, and this is great because the tracks are open. We, as you saw, about 2 miles, two-mile walk, and it's good distance when you're carrying something as a 90-year-old. We waited here. We came here in the afternoon, and then 2 o'clock in the morning, finally a train pulls in, the last train. Fighting going on. There were tracers all over the sky. Mm-hmm. Because there were aircraft up there, and there was a well-known Estonian a colonel with his group over there that was in the pocket, or getting to be in the pocket, and there was fighting going on. Anyway, so he pulls in here, and really slowly, and it was essentially a cattle car, and the doors were open, and what you saw was 3-tier stretchers, and I still remember blood dripping from most of the stretchers. I mean, these were heavily wounded, and what really impressed me was we didn't hear a yell anywhere, anytime. You could occasionally hear a moan, and that was it. And it was really sad. Again, those folks that were fighting about five miles down the road, and the guys that were being pulled out saved our butts, and that's how we got out. You know, that's why you and I, you know, you're here and Mark's here. We're just standing there, hand in hand, and crying on the track, you know, and looking down the track. He says, you know, this was the beginning of the end for our family. At least for a while, and again, you know, I never saw my mother after. It was literally hell. I mean, can you imagine, you know, they said the old story about the same shell not hitting the same hole. He says, the exception was here. and Estonia said, it was literally hell, but where would you run to? We had to hold. Mm-hmm. This was a nice wooded area. I mean, Sinimad, which means blue mountains, actually, are blue hills. I mean, there are not too many hills. I mean, nothing really high here. But after all the battles, there wasn't a tree standing here. It was, you know, it was completely decimated. You can see the sea from here. They had the defense line was in front of Kindergarten Hill from the sea all the way across the field here, about a mile to the right. And the attack came this way, starting on, I believe, on July 27th, 1944. And it was very intense. I mean, there were 4-1 odds. The Estonians didn't have any tanks or anything. They actually destroyed, I believe it was 113 tanks by hand, with just handheld anti-tank weapons and mines they slapped on tanks as they came by. So they overran this once. You can see the trench right here. This was actually they had not fortified this very much. And when they were attacked, and then they pushed back, and the main line of defense was held right here at the what they call Grenadier Hill, and the third hill is right there. You can we're right on top of it. If you look back, it's Hill 69.9, and there were bunkers behind there, and they the tanks got behind it and destroyed those. So this actually, they finally held here, and both sides essentially ran out of blood. I mean, this field is, it's soaked in blood. And they were clearing out tanks and weapons here for years after the war. The Russians had a whole division, an armored division and a regular division, and the Estonians, I think, had like one or two battalions here, and they weren't fully manned. I mean, they were all decimated already, and they held here. Wow. Yeah, there were just remnants of tanks all over this place. For years after the war, before they really cleaned. What they did is immediately after the battles, they demined everything. Yeah, and also even during the fighting, people would go out with disinfectant and just spray their corpses so they wouldn't smell too bad, and because they were decomposing, they had no chance to remove them. So the important reason for me is that's the reason I got out to the west. They held here. If they would have come by here, most of there was a Estonian army contingent on Emajõgi. We'll see that later on. They held them there, but if they would have broken through here, they would have cut them off. My father and I came back to help dig infantry trenches behind the lines. And if this wouldn't have held here, that would have been cut off anyway. The artillery barrage started at 6 o'clock in the morning, and it was so heavy. I mean, it's miles away. You could hear it and you could feel it. It was like an earthquake. Volunteers were being rounded up in Tallinn and other cities and loaded onto trains and brought here in order to help dig fortifications. And so my father volunteered to go. They faced the river, and it's a regular infantry trench. It's a zigzag, and then you have placements for machine guns. See what I've done? I mean, there are bits left, and they've taken the underbrush that they've cleared, and they've dumped it into the trench. So they've essentially filled it up since 5 years ago. Hold it. We're in the wrong place. It's up here. So we can actually go in here. Ugh. But you can see that now how this is laid out. I mean, it's your typical infantry trench, zigzag. And we, because everybody, I think, most people know why it's zigzag.
Why?
You get a hand grenade over here, it doesn't blow up get the people around the corner. That's, There wasn't too much excitement, except one time we got strafed by a Russian fighter. Oh, where you can see where the road starts climbing a little bit. Mm-hmm. That's why we always got run over by about 6 Panzers. We were coming this way, towards the station from Luwa Mesa or Luwa State, where we it was the meeting point for the trench digging or fortification. Anyway, we came this way and just got out of the way over here. And they were whipping down the road, and they were retreating. And then we came across the tracks here, and the And the train was in here, with the caboose was right here in front of the station. And so, and again, it was, you know, this train was just sitting here, and it was, I think it was full of troops. I know that in the caboose, you had a, you know, a bunch of officers in there. And we went into the station, and my father asked the station master, you know, if we could get on a train, or if that was, you know, he said, yeah, it's the last train. He says, you know, Tartu is being attacked or overrun. I forget what it was. And he said, well, I can't tell you whether you can. He said, you'll have to go and ask the officer in charge in the caboose. And that's where we went. And, you know, I was a little kid with blonde hair, and I got in there, and they rubbed my head, and there was a big pot belly stove in the middle of the caboose, because it was starting to get cold already, you know, in the evenings and in September.
I sat back and just, you know, essentially got into a trance. You know, here I am going back behind an Iron Curtain, you know, from a, you know, just 60 miles apart from Finland to Estonia. One is free and the other one is essentially locked up.
It was with great apprehension that we crossed the sea and got to Tallinn.
And I remember looking at the swells and looking at the seagulls and saying, boy, this wouldn't it be wonderful if you know, if all the people in the world could be like seagulls. There would be no national barriers. Essentially, you could fly wherever you wanted to go or go wherever you wanted to go. I was very close to my mother and my sister. Salome, my mother, was, again, what I remember of her. And when I first saw my sister Maimo in 1982, when we came off the ferry from Finland, it was almost like it was my mother. She reminded me so much of my mother, not only the way she looked, but also her personality. Really warm, and didn't have a bad word about anybody. This is one of the last things your mother said before she died. She said, Kalev will return.
I think it filled a big void in his life.
For the first time in my life, I was able to attend the Estonian Song Festival, which takes place every 5 years. And it's hard to explain to people unless you were an Estonian.
You could really see the communist side of it, the Russian side. And they made their presence quite known. But when the people themselves start moving down towards the stage, as the Russians were leaving mostly, and all the Estonians moved closer to, we moved as close as we could. It was scary, and then to stand up on chairs and just pumping the umbrellas, you could just see the patriotism in them. It was just incredible. And so many of them just standing around in the rain, just tears in their eyes because they were singing this forbidden song, and just over and over. It was incredible. I just saw nothing that was good except the people who lived with this and put up with it every day because they had to. How bad things were, they couldn't get any worse. So they said, another famous saying of theirs was, we must live. So if they didn't make humor out of something, it was all that more depressing.
What really got her through the war is her humor. Everything was against the grain, she would make a joke out of it. Of course, that was the nature of all the Estonians. I mean, how do you survive? I mean, it's like an infantry guy in the trenches. If you don't have a joke, you don't survive very well. So it was, for instance, the term used, living under the golden system. That was the Soviet system. Or anything that went wrong, like an elevator, it's Russian stuff. You know?
As I related to Chaz, or Kalev, upon leaving Tallinn, it was an eerie feeling as we pulled away from the dock. It was sort of like the rats deserting a sinking ship, But I felt no guilt, only a very deep sadness that they had to be left behind in that godforsaken place that was their home, to a life of work and waiting in lines for their daily sustenance. Though we had seen some beautiful historic sites, Tallinn gave me a sense of seeing the total overview in shades of gray, black, brown, and off-white. There was nothing pretty or happy in that land of theirs, only their sense of humor about their predicament and their keen sense of patriotism. Without either, they would sink quickly. They could go on endlessly relating stories about the golden system, which they had to live and abide by. But strangely enough, there were very few individual gripes, but rather they were speaking for all Estonians when they spoke of the pitfalls and shortcomings of Soviet rule. And they would end their story so many times with the words, "We must live."
Skyline, the steeples, the skyline, especially when you come in from the water. Yeah, it's beautiful. You know, it's so different. Oh, it's beautiful. Just the old town is one of the most interesting places I've been to. You know, the history, we don't get to see things, you know, this old in America, so.
We don't have anything this old in the U.S., so it's really unique.
A German movie company was in Tallinn filming Shakespeare because it was one of the better preserved ancient cities.
They try to clean it up a little bit for the 1980 Olympics. So when I came here in 1980 for the first time, it was still in relatively good shape, but everything was running down. There was no money invested as far as restoration was concerned. In fact,
yeah, this is the oldest, one of the oldest drugstores in Europe, right here in good old Tallinn, and it's been in continuous operation since 1422.
Oh, I just love the feeling of, like, you can feel the knights on their horseback, you know, on the cobblestone. It's so crowded now, though. It's different with all the tourists.
This place is really unbelievable. The amount of tourists that come through here, you know, from the time that I was here first time, there was no tourists here in 1982, other than a few, you know, Russians that came in here for Ricky. That was it. And now you just get busload after busload walking around with numbers.
You need to climb up top of Olavista. That's a great view up there. How many steps?
258.
He counted them all.
Ow, ow, ow.
Fat Margaret. it's the fattest tower in Tallinn, and it's you know, next to the sea gate, and I believe it was added to the original construction when the cannons came into play. It went, you know, when gunpowder was introduced.
Yeah, this is the lower city wall, and extends all around the lower city. And then the Estonian name for this place is Torni de Veljak, which means field of towers. This is in commemoration of the people who were deported, you know, cry to the heavens what happened to them. Yeah, these were the people that were arrested as soon as the Russians came in, the communist Russians came in everybody in 1940. There. Most of them rounded up and
killed instantly.
Killed or, you know, taken of somebody instantly. Most of them were killed.
Yeah, a lot of people came here and never went home.
Yeah.
Literally. Either they were killed right here in the basement or they were shipped out. Never to be seen again.
I think there were this ministry in Estonia time also.
Could be, huh?
Internal affairs, yeah.
Yeah, internal affairs is here again, so.
Yes, yeah. Keeping up the tradition.
Yeah. Just not making it as painful.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
Yeah, this is the symbol of the country. And you got a good shot with the flag up there in the wind.
It's great.
It's fantastic. You'll love it. The people, the tradition, seeing friends.
The folk music that I enjoy so much. We sat and sang and the kids danced around.
The details are really nice. They get really involved with the traditions, the clothes, the dance festival. People are very passionate about it. So I think it's exciting.
Roughly 8,000 dancers are continuously doing something for a solid hour and a half, 2 hours. And it's something again that you have to see to appreciate.
I could not believe that many kids could be organized and be on a field at one time or be in that concert shell and just be so organized. All the splinter groups coming together at one time without practice, it just amazed me. Yeah, just all the different colors of coming together, really neat. That was the most enjoyable part of the trip.
This is a traditional thing. The parade starts downtown, Victory Square, which was declared Victory Square after the War of Independence in 1920, victory there. Everybody lines up, the dancers and the singers. And the parade goes for several hours. They all march from the downtown to the song festival ground. Rain or shine.
The most of part of I like the way how they walk through the city. This is very good. You're walking, you have the your name, everybody sees it, your school name, and people screaming, "Hey, you! Yeah, we whipping out!" It's great. Everybody see you, and you have the clothes on, and everything is perfect. This one is very good. It's like you're president or something like that.
You go through town, you have people lying on both sides, there's also a mythical tradition. If you spot somebody in the parade that's a member of your family, that's good luck to you.
Mm-hmm.
when they march into the stadium, they put these Estonian flags on either side of the stadium, wherever they happen to be, you know, which side the choir is going to be. And so by the time the parade is over, you have hundreds of Estonian flags just lining up the sides of the shell where the choir eventually starts singing.
Just picture it as the Olympic of song every 5 years. You know, that's what it really is. The runner comes in and starts going up the tower and comes out at every level and then eventually gets on top of it and lights it.
As the cauldron is lit exactly at the same time, it opens with the same song called Dawn. And I'm breaking up now just thinking about it. But you just feel part of it. It's a very powerful song. And essentially what it means, again, Dawn, meaning the nation is reborn. You have essentially 30,000 singers on stage inside the shell. Very powerful. You really need to be physically there. You know, it's part of the identity of Estonia.
And the music. Oh, the whole choir sings at the same time, and the dirigent, the director, that he can direct all of the singers, because from one side to the other, the music would travel, but to have them all sing at the exact same time and have it converge, it's something that you have to be there to believe. I can believe it. To sing is one thing. That's even more unbelievable. But I'm going to be a part of the audience, and that to me is almost as good. But the second day when we sat way in the back on the hill in the grass, that was fantastic.
We were way up on a knoll watching down to just very impressive. It was just a sea of people, but just incredible. Just lots of singing going on and just happy people. And you could see how that could have gotten them through a lot of bad times.
Whether you're born there, or you're a son or a grandson or something, you know, the connection is extremely strong.
People have relatives that died and those stories ended. It's like candles that got blown out and other candles that got lit and stay lit. And Eesti is such a small country that we have to keep it alive. You are an Eestlane. We don't count drops of blood. You are an Eestlane. And you're here because you care about the country. We're such a small country. We include everybody that cares about being Estonian.
And this is just one family of so many. There are that many stories.
no matter what. We will survive.